tonight on Last Friday, we talk with one of Portland State Representatives, Ben Chipman. We discuss his current run for Maine State Senate, and we look at all five ballot initiatives. Our conversation is slightly edited for time to leave room for essential independent media coming out of North Dakota. As it is now November, we take some time to say a Thanksgiving prayer, and we enjoy some incredible music from Trevor Hall. Last Friday is produced by Maine Sky Media and an all-volunteer staff who are dedicated to bringing voice and visibility to local activism, art, and music. We hope you enjoy. I want to introduce Ben Chipman, our state representative here in Portland, who is running for Senate this year around in 2016. And tell me about the way you're running your campaign.
I'm not taking any private donations from private donors or political action committees or special interest groups or lobbyists or anything like that. I'm running as what's called a clean elections candidate.
Okay.
Maine is one of three or four states, or maybe there's a few more than that now, that have a system of public campaign financing for candidates who choose to use it. It's an optional system. And what it does is it allows a candidate to focus their time on meeting voters and talking about issues and not spending time raising money from lobbyists and groups that they'll likely feel like they owe favors to after they win, if they do win, once they're in office. And we see a lot of that at the national level and at the state level in some states. And before we had clean elections set up in Maine, this is something the voters approved by referendum in 96, which I was part of my work
doing.
And we strengthened it last year. Before we had clean elections, the lobbyists in the halls of Augusta had a lot more clout with legislators than they do now. And I think that's a good thing, you know. And so it really, it's public financing, it's limited, it's a limited amount of money, and it's not something everybody can just go and tap into. You have to demonstrate support in your district. So for a Senate candidate, I had to go out and collect a small $5 donation from 175 voters in the Senate district in order to qualify for the funding. So I demonstrated support from constituents and I qualified for funding. And this is available for House candidates, Senate candidates, and for candidates for governor in Maine.
Right. Yeah. That's awesome. I didn't know that. I wouldn't have expected that from any of the like major parties. I didn't know really at the state level if there was also something that perhaps bigger businesses in Maine were put, you know, trying to lobby and support people's campaigns for them. So I think I'm a little jaded on the whole.
You still have that. I mean, there's still privately funded candidates who raise and spend a lot of money from businesses and wealthy donors, and that's, you know, it's an optional system, clean elections. But what we did last fall through that referendum is voted to strengthen this law, and so now it really, it almost does set up like a level playing field where clean election candidates can have the same amount of funding as a privately funded candidate in their race. And so it's really designed to help get the influence of big money out of politics. So that, you know, there's incentive to run clean elections, but if you don't, you know, you could be against a candidate that has public funding, and the influence of special interests is, I think, greatly diminished under the system. So
that's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome, and that should be what we're doing nationally. I mean, it's just there's something we have to do something, because and what's unfortunate for me is no matter who gets elected here in the next week, because we are recording but 1 week before the election,
about a week and a half out. We're about 10 days out.
Yeah. You know? So this is a pressing time this is a moment in history where people are, you know, our country is, I would say, simmering, if not coming to a boiling point, more so than I remember in so far growing up. And I was born in the 70s, late 60s. But so, you know, things have gotten hot, but not like now. This is crazy. So, and what bothers me is that, no matter who you're voting for, I don't mean to offend anyone out there, but nothing's going to change, I don't think. I mean, I hear talk of change, but I don't feel like there's going to be change. So, as much as I'd like to see, as much as I had hoped for with President Obama. But so, with that said, I mean, there's a ton of things that you're running as that type of candidate. What do you think are the things that Maine is, the most critical things that are facing us, and some of the things that our governor has sort of either shut down or blocked us from moving forward on?
There's a lot of issues. Yeah. You know, this year we came really close to passing a bill for regarding solar power that would have stimulated millions of dollars of investment in solar. It would have created, I think, 600 or 800 good-paying jobs across the state, which we could really use, particularly in areas outside of Portland. And the governor vetoed it, and we fell like a couple votes short of overriding the veto. You know, we have a lot of opportunity in Maine around energy, around economic development, creating good, sustainable, clean energy jobs, environmentally friendly jobs.
Let me stop you right there. Yeah. It affects more than that, because they started a program at Northern Maine Community College they started a whole program for green energy jobs where they're training people to work on solar panels. And, you know, like, so when he stops something like that, it's like a cascading, it just like it cascades right down even into education. Now these kids will go through, pay their money, get the training, and there will be no job here for them.
They'll
leave the state. Yeah.
Which is a big problem we have in Maine. I mean, Maine, we have, you know, one of the biggest crises that are facing the state is the fact that people are dying faster than babies are being born in 14 out of 16 of our counties in the state. You know, and so we have this huge problem. If you look at economic forecasts for 10 years out, it shows those forecasts that have been done by Charlie Colgan, who used to be the state economist, show that retail businesses are going to have to, in the future, 10 years from now, be paying like $20 an hour to attract someone to move to Maine to work at Rennie's or Walmart or to work at Hannaford, you know, because there's not going to be enough workers to work those jobs.
Right.
Because we're going to have a huge shortage of workers. So I'm a big fan of, you know, refugees and immigrants, because they come here and they want to work and they can help fill that workplace shortage that we're going to have. You know, anything we can do to retain and keep young people here who grow up in Maine, to keep them in Maine after they graduate from college. Like the Opportunity Maine program is a great program that I was part of helping get set up. I did a lot of work on the signature drive to get that established, but it's an in-state tax credit for college students to stay living and working in Maine once they graduate. And I'd like to like ramp it up and make it a little more aggressive than it is, but it's definitely helping towards keeping young people in Maine, and that's what we need to do.
You started that?
I worked on the signature drive to help bring it to the ballot, and then what happened was once the signatures were turned in, the legislature adopted it without it having to go to the ballot, which is rare. But they liked the idea so much, they just adopted it. So
let me say it. I volunteered for that.
Okay.
Very, very briefly, but it was the first time I'd turned my life. My life was going in the wrong direction.
Okay.
Some time ago when this started, and I was turning my life around, and I volunteered for that as like a positive action.
It's like 2007.
That's funny. That was sort of when I I was turning my life around, and I volunteered for that. It was like the first thing that I did to start like becoming what I consider the part of the solution rather than part of the problem. That's wonderful, man. That's awesome.
Yeah, actually, Senator Alfond was a big part of spearheading that, and he was working with the League of Young Voters here in Portland. He was the director of that group, and they were sort of at the center of, you know, helping get signatures collected and get that off the ground.
Yeah.
And he then went on to become the state senator in this district and served 8 years, and he's coming to the end of his last term. He's under term limits, he can't run again. And I went on myself in 2010 to get elected to the Maine House of Representatives. I've served 3 terms there, representing Parkside, Bayside, and East Bayside neighborhoods. And seeing that Senator Alfond was term limited, our other state senator from Portland, Ann Haskell, chose not to run again, and like 3 or 4 of our 8 House members in Portland aren't able to run again or chose not to run again. So we're seeing this sort of huge loss of like over half the members of the Portland delegation in Augusta. I was encouraged by people I know to run for the Senate seat that Senator Alfond is vacating, and so that's part of what prompted me to decide to run in the primary and seek the nomination of the Democratic Party and to run for the seat, because we need people that have experience in public policy and experience in Augusta. In the state Senate seats particularly, because there's so much at stake. I mean, it's just a lot, particularly around budget issues and funding for Portland, for education, for social services, that if we don't have people up there that have experience, we're really going to suffer. The city's going to suffer. And that's what I was concerned about. And so I went, you know, I talked to a lot of friends about it, and I could have easily like run for my 4th term for House and probably got reelected the last time and served 8 years and been content with that. But was encouraged to run for the Senate seat and just felt like there's a real need to have experience there. And so I ran for it and I won the nomination in the primary in June, and now I'm running in November for the general election.
One of the things that I'm interested in is you mentioned it earlier, is you were would like to see more immigrant population moving here. And a friend of ours, I know that you know Jonah Fertig, is helping with creating cooperatives and in that community. So is there something that's going on in Augusta that you think would be able to help this move along to bring more immigrants in different ways, like for different, you know, more opportunities to start their own business and more opportunities for, you know, whatever, a smoother start when they get here?
Well, there's certainly more that can be done. I'd like to help establish an immigrant business development loan fund, and I did put in a bill to do that a few years ago and worked with a group of immigrants. We weren't successful then, but I'd like to revisit the idea. And basically the thought behind that is, you know, immigrants who move here from other countries, they start out with like no credit. They have no established credit here, and so it's really hard for them to get loans to start businesses. And in some cases, they had businesses in the country that they're coming from and had to flee, you know, war and what was going on there to come to a safe place, and they come here and they can't even get credit or get a loan to start a business here. And so I'd like to revisit that idea to make sure that they're able to have access to credit, to be able to get startup funds to start businesses here. The other thing I'd like to spend a little more time doing is just trying to really get my colleagues in the rural parts of Maine, legislators in rural Maine, to understand like the real need that we have for workers, the workplace shortage we're going to have 5 and 10 years out from now that I mentioned earlier, and how important that it is that we as a state provide some initial funding to help immigrants and asylum-seeking families with the cost of housing and the cost of food through general assistance. We had this big battle last year over this in the state budget, and general assistance funding for, which is a program, just to explain for folks that may be watching that don't understand what that is. General assistance is a social safety net program that the state of Maine's had for a long time. The state provides most of the funding, and the cities and towns kick in the additional, where anybody in Maine that's having a hard time paying their rent or their mortgage payment on their house, if they own a home, or need just a little money for food or something like that, and they have no funding to pay for those things for their family, they can go to their city or town office and they can get help through general assistance to cover those basic expenses, and it's sort of on a month-by-month basis. But it's basically to make sure that no one goes without or falls through the cracks on basic necessities. And we had a big fight last year over general assistance funding for asylum seekers, you know, and whether the state should continue to help fund that. And obviously a lot of immigrants and asylum-seeking families, they come to Portland more than they do, you know, Skowhegan or Buxton or other towns in the state. But so we're, you know, we get reimbursed from the state. At the time it was 90% we got reimbursed for the general assistance funding for anybody, including the asylum seeking families. And we had a big fight over it, and unfortunately the state budget did not, that got passed out of appropriations, didn't include general assistance for asylum seeking families. And what it would have meant for Portland would be 900 asylum seeking families would have gone homeless if this budget cut had gone through. So I voted against the budget on principle because of that. And it still passed. Unfortunately, it passed without the funding there, but we did pass a separate bill a couple of days later that provided the funding for it. But then there's some things being done behind the scenes with rulemaking and things to kind of hold that up from DHHS and the governor. So it's still being worked out. But what I'd like to do, if I'm successful in this election, is, you know, really zero in on that and try to do some things to really impress upon to my colleagues in the rural areas how important that this is to the state's economy. You know, because we need workers, we need people that want to start businesses, you know, and folks that are fleeing war-torn countries that come here, they're applying for citizenship, which takes time, but in the meantime they're seeking asylum, they're here legally, there's no issue with the legality of them being here, and they want to contribute, and they want to, but you know, for the first sort of 6 months or so until they can get their green card and work, they're not legally allowed to work by way of federal law, but yet they're here and they're ready to jump in and work when they get the green card for that first sort of 4 or 5 or 6 months. If we can,
I can't even understand
the importance of general assistance for them until they get off their feet is critical, and they will it'll pay back the state so much more. I mean, the payback to us as a state and to our economy is huge for that little bit of investment up front
that we provide. We encourage them to come. We say you have asylum seekers, and we bring. There must be something that allows them to come here.
They come through immigrant and refugee resettlement programs.
The country knows that they're coming here.
The state
knows that they're coming here.
They come through a legal process that's set up by the federal government. They're here legally. They apply for asylum.
Right.
They apply for a green card so they can work. But in the meantime, they're not legally allowed to work.
Or get services. You know,
well, they're allowed to get general assistance.
As long as
we provide the funding for the first sort of 6 months until they get their green cards, then they're off the ground, they're working, and they don't need general assistance anymore.
This is one of the things that has me screaming at a television, I heard that Governor LePage wanted to cut that. And I was like, so you're not allowing them to work? They're already here.
Don't allow them to work by way of federal law. Don't provide any assistance by way of state
general assistance funding. What are they supposed to do? What do you wait till they...
Well, then it falls on the city.
So the
city of Portland, to the rescue of these 900 asylum-seeking families, the city of Portland, by a 5-4 vote, I believe, on the city council, set up a community support program as a fallback to the state not funding this in the budget to make sure that these 900 families didn't go homeless. We didn't know that was going to pass the city council at the time.
Right.
That's why I held out and I didn't vote for the budget. Luckily, about a week or two after that budget passed without the funding, the city set up their own program and was willing to pay for it. Like I said, a 5-4 vote. It's one of those controversial 5-4 votes you hear about in the city council, but sometimes it's important that something pass, even if it's 5-4, in a case like this. So I was happy that the city did that. They agreed to fund it for a year and wait to see what happens with the separate bill that was passed, which was sponsored by a state senator from Scarborough.
Right. Yep. We're gonna hold there. I'm gonna take a break in a second, but first I want to talk about the shirt that I'm wearing. This organization, LumenARRT, which you can look up at www.lumenart.com, probably right here. What a great organization! I happen to help them out, but they project images and along with audio and other video sources. Concerning issues like this. So on the first Friday, next Friday, they'll be doing a thing on immigration, on asylum seeking here in Maine and how important it is to them. And it's actually really, it's inspiring, it's heartbreaking, but it's a wonderful new way of showing, getting the, bringing visibility to issues like this. Okay. So great work that LumenARRT is doing. I definitely wanted to mention that, and proud to be able to help them out occasionally myself. So let's take a break, and then we'll come back in a second, and we'll talk a little bit more.
Sounds good.
All right. Right back.
Hey, what's up, everyone? This is Lorenzo with Unicorn Riot. We're at a blockade on County Road 134 that was set up when the Oshetisakoan decided to move their winter camp to treaty land, to 1851 treaty land, and the direct path of the Dakota Access Pipeline. They're going to be staying here, I think, until this situation is resolved, and they're saying that they're here to defend the water, they're here to protect the people who are defending the water actively and living in that space, and they're not planning to go anywhere. So we're at this 1806 blockade, which is in front of the new Oshetisakoan winter camp, which is about maybe half a mile down that way in the direct path of the pipeline. About 4 miles north is actually a sort of now military installment with Humvees, police, all sort of prepping this to come this way, and that's why this blockade is here. They want to ensure that the water protectors who are in that camp are safe and at least there's a line before they get to them. We have somebody who's been at the blockade for a while right now.
Basically what we're doing here is, it started as a demonstration to let the world know, to wake everybody up a little bit more about our issue. They're trying to drill. They're just right over this hill, actually. This is our no surrender line. So we're just here to protect our elders, our women and children back at camp, and to protect the Miniwachoni. we're calling up all the nations, all the drum groups, all the indigenous people and the non-indigenous people that just want us to help support water, help support this earth, and help support sovereignty as a nation.
We're at the Sacred Ground Camp. It's been here since September 3rd, since the dog attacks. We're about maybe a half a mile away from that first blockade we were showing you. The construction is actually behind us, just almost a mile or two away to our west. And now we wanted to bring you here so you can hear people's voices from this camp that's been here actively kind of waiting for everyone to come, or waiting for when the construction was going to meet them, and they have no intention of ever leaving, from my understanding, and we're going to hear about that now.
We are at Sacred Ground Camp. This is located on the sacred grounds. Our ancestors' burial sites is right there behind you. We've been here protecting it since December 3rd, since Dappled came and attacked us with the pepper spray and the dogs and the physical assaults. I was there for it all. I seen it all. Came back here that same night and established this camp. Been here ever since.
Decolonize your mind. Put your weapons down.
There's two LRADs from my understanding. You can hear two of them go in. That's really loud and really uncomfortable. People are still in the front waving flags.
I'm gonna find the LRAD again.
Humvees with snipers in the turrets up there as well. And they're telling everyone to move south.
If he will only listen to us and understand our struggles for the water, for the benefit of everybody, we wouldn't be in this spot. That's all we're here, is to protect the water and the sacred integrity of this land and our relationship to each other.
These lines of police officers, they're there because the water protectors moved on when they saw construction and happening right down there. You can see the excavators, they're bringing in railroad ties. And it looks like they're making an arrest. So. They're making more and more lines. There's a big circle of people praying behind us, a bunch of people on the road. And here they've been holding this ground. They don't want them to come into this camp. You can see all these teepees, and the police already made it clear that they're planning to take them all down once they get here. Now they're holding a multi-round grenade launcher. But now they have left until rounds aimed at people. There are big OC canisters as well. You can see the police officers have now made a kind of quarter all the way around it and are slowly trying to push everyone out of this camp.
So hard for me to watch the people get pepper sprayed. So hard for me to see, you know, children coming up crying, you know, where's mom? Where's dad? They're in jail. You can't trust the United States government. This is the United States government doing this. When you have the National Guard coming out, that's the United States. You can't trust your sheriff's department. You can't trust your police. We've dedicated ourselves to protecting the people, to protecting the land, to protecting these sacred sites.
So we're at the big camp, also called the Oshetashakoan camp, also called the Overflow camp. I just wanted to show you it's still here, even though that part of it has moved to the easement line. People are still here. They've been winterizing. I've been witnessing people like actively get ready for a North Dakota winter, which is incredible to witness. And just wanted to show it to you really quick. They're still here. They're going nowhere, regardless of what happens down the road. Folks are here to defend the water. They're not going anywhere.
Thanksgiving Day, November 28, 1986. Thanks for the wild turkey and passenger pigeons destined to be shit out through wholesome American guts. Thanks for a continent to despoil and poison. Thanks for Indians to provide a modicum of challenge and danger. Thanks for vast herds of bison to kill and skin, leaving the carcasses to rot. Thanks for bounties on wolves and coyotes. Thanks for the American dream to vulgarize and falsify until the bare lies shine. Thanks to the KKK, the nigger killing lawmen feeding their notches. The decent church-going women with their mean, pinched, bitter, evil faces. Thanks to Kill a Queer for Christ. Thanks for laboratory aid.
More pepper sprays, tons of pepper spray in the air.
Thanks for prohibition and the war against
the wind is sort of on.
Thanks for a country where nobody is allowed to mind his own business. Thanks for a nation of finks. Yes, thanks for all the memories. All right, let's see your arms. You always were a headache, and you always were a bore. Thanks for the last and greatest betrayal of the last and greatest of human dreams.
I know.
Okay, welcome back, and we are going to finish this conversation, but we have a lot to talk about. This might be a longer show than normal, so the first thing is we should go through all of the things we're all about to vote for here in Maine in a week from now.
Yep.
So you want to start at the top or the bottom of the list?
We can start with question one and run down through them. I guess, I think it's valuable for people to know there's some really important public policy issues on the ballot this year. There's five citizen-initiated referendum questions where citizens groups went out and collected over 60,000 signatures to put these questions on the ballot. Not an easy task at all. Right. And they were successful. And I think, some people are like, why is there so many referendum questions? I think one of the reasons why there are is because...
can't get anything done in Augusta.
Well, I mean, we've gotten a lot done in Augusta, but these are issues that are either too controversial that the legislature doesn't want to address that we wouldn't be able to override a veto on even if we did take them up there. So they're important issues that need to be considered and have sort of, it's sort of their time, I think, in some cases. They've been working away for many years, and there are issues that, need to be addressed.
Yeah.
And they're on the ballot, and now as voters, we have the ability to address them at the ballot box.
Good deal.
And so question one is the referendum to legalize marijuana, tax and regulate marijuana. Mm-hmm. That's on the ballot as question one.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people kind of understand what that issue is. I believe it's a 10% tax that would be assessed, and there'd be retail establishments that would be licensed by the state that would be set up to be able to, sell marijuana to adults 21 and older.
Yeah.
And there's a provision for social clubs, so sort of like a bar kind of environment where adults 21 and older can go to a bar and have a beer together. They'd be able to do the same thing in one of these marijuana social clubs, and that's part of the referendum as well.
I didn't know that.
So it's, I think, designed to kind of just, tax and regulate marijuana, make it legal, and get, I believe, about $30 million in tax revenue would be coming into the state. So right now it's not taxed. It's obviously in the black market. We're not getting any tax revenue from it. And, I think one could argue that by having it in the black market, it's more accessible to kids because, drug dealers aren't going to card someone and make sure they're a certain age to sell them drugs. So, getting it out of the black market, I think probably hopefully helps make it less accessible to kids, get some tax revenue the state could use, and not criminalize adults that are 21 and older that are choosing to use marijuana for their own personal use.
We're not getting the tax revenue, and when it's criminalized, now we as citizens are paying to put people through court systems, put people in jail, give them, parole officers afterwards. I mean, we pay for it for a long time.
Well, then they aren't able to get a job or get student loans and go to college or do things to sort of better their lives because they got a record. I think that I'm just so I'm supporting all the referendum questions.
Okay.
One through five
So
question two is about education funding and a little bit of background on that. Several years ago, citizens in the state voted to fund education at 55% from the state at the state level. So the state would provide 55% of the funding to cities and towns to cover the cost of K-12 education in the local school districts.
Okay.
Unfortunately, the legislature has never met that mandate. They've never actually got the education funding level up to 55%. I think they've come close getting it to 48 to 49%. Currently, I think it's slipped down a little bit, around 45% maybe. I think here in Portland we get 44% from the state, or maybe 43%, but it's not at the 55% level. So question two would provide funding for K-12 education. 55% would be paid for at the state level across the state. Every district would get 55% paid for by the state.
Yeah.
It's paid for by assessing a 3% income tax surcharge on income earned by residents over $200,000, at the $200,000 level and above. So, just to be clear, so people understand how it would work, if somebody right now, if an attorney or doctor, somebody's earning $225,000 a year, and there are some people in Maine that make more than that, it would impact about 2% of our population. The only 2% of people in Maine make over $200,000 a year. But if someone's making $225,000 a year, the first $200,000 would not be impacted. the additional $25,000 that they earn would be taxed at a 3% additional higher level than what the rest of their income is taxed at.
Outrageous.
So it's not really dramatic. It's not really dramatic, but right. I mean, it would. And before LePage became governor, before Governor LePage took office,
our state
income tax was at 8.5%, and it's now been lowered down to 6.5% for everybody. Yeah. Under question two, it would raise that back up to a little higher than it was before Governor LePage took office and these income tax reductions were passed, only for those income levels over $200,000. So it's pretty, I think, pretty fair.
Yeah.
And it generates $133 million in funding for education. So it's,
I think it's more important
for the school districts.
Absolutely, more than fair.
Because we got schools that are crumbling here in Portland. We got four schools that need to be renovated. I've been out to Presumpscot. I've seen the leaking ceiling out there. I've seen the portable classrooms at these schools. And it's just, you know, we need funding for education to fix our schools. We need to pay our teachers fairly. And that money has to come from somewhere.
Yeah.
And so we're respecting sort of the will of the voters from several years ago where they wanted it funded at this level, providing a funding mechanism for it. So question two is what that one's about.
Okay.
Question three is the background checks for private gun sales.
Yep.
So in Maine, we have a loophole in our law currently. It's been there for a long time where if somebody wants to buy a gun through a private gun sale, through a classified ad on Uncle Henry's or online, they can go and do that with no background check. They can reply to an ad, they can say, I want to buy this gun, they can show up, meet somebody somewhere and buy a gun, there's no background check done.
Also known as getting it off the street. I don't care if you go through an ad, you're buying a gun off the street.
I mean, if you go to a store or a business, you have to have a background check, but if they don't go to a gun shop and they buy it from someone privately, no background check. And it's
in Detroit, where I'm from, it's called getting a gun off the street. But I don't know if it's anything different in Maine. But
I mean, Maine is not, you know, of all the states, we don't have a real high level of gun violence, but we do have gun violence.
Sure.
And in states that have passed this law to require background checks in private gun sales, they've seen gun use and domestic violence cases go down by 48%.
Right.
They've seen a dramatic drops in crime, gun-related crime in those states. So that would be a good reason to vote for it. But the other thing is, over the last 10 years, it's my understanding that there's been about 1,500 guns that have been purchased through private gun sales in Maine and taken back to other states and used in the commission of crimes.
Yeah.
And that's data that is accessible that people can look up and see. And so, you know, even if we don't have a high level of gun violence here or people feel like Maine's a safe state, why do we need this? Well, Maine is contributing to violence in cities in Boston and New York and other states by way of people being able to come up here, buy these guns without a background check where they wouldn't have been able to do so in those states because they have laws in place that require a background check. They buy the guns here and bring them back there and then crime's committed. So we're contributing to crime in other areas, even if there isn't huge levels of gun crime here. But I mean, I think there ought to be background checks for every gun sale. So I'm, you know. Question four is a really big one, raising the minimum wage.
I have my own opinion on that, but I'm glad that something's being done in that direction.
That's, I mean, it's not a huge jump all at once, but it does raise the minimum wage in Maine over time. It would initially go up by a dollar, or initially would go from $7.50 to $9, and then each year it goes up a dollar to 10, to 11, and eventually to 12, and then it ties it to the rate of inflation. So as inflation goes up, the minimum wage goes up without having to have another referendum vote or a bill through the legislature. So it also, over time, gets rid of the reduced tipped wage for tipped workers and eventually gets them up to a $12 wage and put in tracks that with inflation as well. So it helps the tipped workers, it helps all workers, and you know, I think a rising tide lifts all boats, you know, so if we raise a minimum wage, it's probably going to end up resulting in wage increases for other people that are already making more than minimum wage now. It's going to have an effect across the board, and you know, I think in general we need to look at ways to get wages up in Maine and also look at ways to keep housing costs stable or keep them down. Like rents are really high in Portland and property taxes are really high for homeowners, so whatever we can do to get wages up and keep, you know, rents and property taxes down for people, it's going to just improve everybody's overall ability to afford to live in the state.
Good deal.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll go to five now. Okay. Sorry, I had to jump in on
that. That's your favorite one, right?
Yeah, five is the one, because five is national implications as far as I'm concerned. So, so we'll tell us about five.
Five's good. You know, ranked choice voting, before I ran for the House of Representatives in 2010, I served for 1 year on the Portland Charter Commission.
Yep.
2009, I was elected to serve a year there, and what we did was we rewrote the city charter. Mm-hmm. We brought forward a proposal to make Portland's mayor elected by the population, which it wasn't before that. For 88 years, the mayor was appointed by the council. They all took turns, and it wasn't elected. So people really want to see the mayor be elected, and I thought, well, if we're going to elect the mayor, why don't we do it through with a majority support and do it with ranked choice voting? So we have a mayor that's got support of the majority of residents, and get rid of this sort of spoiler effect where if you have, you know, multiple candidates, people will say, well, you know, I want to vote for this third party candidate or this independent, but I don't want to waste my vote there. So they vote strategically and they vote for sort of the lesser of two evils as opposed to who they really want.
Right.
Ranked choice voting lets you vote for whoever you want. And so I brought that forward and we got it into the proposal, and we actually brought forward a mayor that's elected with ranked choice voting. We've had two elections now. It's worked out fine.
Yeah.
No voter confusion at the polls. People rank their candidates in order of preference, and we get a majority winner, and there's no such thing as a wasted vote anymore. So that's part of why I did that, though, in the Charter Commission process, was to so Portland could realize the benefits of ranked choice voting, but also to show the state how it worked, because there's no place in Maine where it had been used.
Right.
Anywhere, locally or at the state level. So now that we've shown Maine it can work well in Portland, I think we're ready to take it to the next level, and that's what question five does. So that's another one. I did some work to help bring that to the ballot. It's on the ballot for people to vote on, and I mean, I think it's
absolutely
I think it's
critical. Do you know where ranked choice voting comes from? Is there like a story behind who invented this?
I don't know the history on it. When I first brought it forward, a lot of my colleagues on the Charter Commission didn't even know what it was. I got a group called Fair Vote. They're a national group that promotes ranked choice voting. And I got the director of that group, Rob Ritchie, to come up and give a presentation to the Charter Commission to just kind of explain how it works and what the benefits are. And after that presentation, most of my colleagues were on board and they wanted to go forward with it. There's a few groups nationally that promote this and go around and work on it state by state in different counties, different cities. I don't think there's any state so far that has ranked choice voting on a statewide level. There's some counties and certainly a lot of cities and towns, but no state that does it on a statewide level, and I think Maine could become the first state to do that. But I could be wrong on that, but I think that's the case. We could be really making some history with
I think that would be wonderful to see that happen. You know, because also, even to begin the flow towards a national election that way would be so helpful in this country. And we have to get a third party going somehow. I mean, I don't want to jump into the, like, who are you voting for next week for president?
Well, we need more choices.
We absolutely need more choices.
I mean, choices are healthy for democracy. Right. It's just good for the process to have more choices, more options, and to have a vibrant democracy. I think that ranked choice voting really helps that.
Yeah, no, this year I've argued with more of my friends that I've had for 20, 30 years, right, on different things from, you know, Bernie Sanders to Green Party to, and now, like, who are you going to vote for? And I'm voting for who I want for president. I don't care if they're going to become president or not. So, I would rather a doctor be our president than a lawyer. So let me say it that way. Absolutely critical. Especially in the state, I think, after we've seen what has happened when three different candidates go for governor.
They all split the vote, and then we ended up with Governor LePage.
Yeah,
with 38% of the vote.
Who serves no one in the state?
Serves 38%.
But he serves those people that vote for him.
Yeah,
it's like when you vote for the Republican Party, they're not being served by the Republican Party. Hmm. Part of why they're, I think why the party is going to fall apart, which is, why we see it falling apart right now.
Yeah.
Should we make bets on whether it falls apart? I don't know. I bet you, America, that 4 years from now, there's a third party, and the Republican Party might be one of them, but it'll be a weak one, or a weaker one anyway. But
certainly a lot of discontent and fractured, groups on the right end of things. You know,
it
Republicans
is.
And the whole, nomination process for president and who they ended up with, and 16 or 18 candidates, and it's just a lot of discontent and frustration, and
It just seems like they are voting themselves, right?
Well, if they had,
I wonder if they'd had ranked choice voting, if they would have ended up with Donald Trump.
They might have ended up with John Kasich or something.
Right. right. And then you have 16 people on stage, or however many they had on stage. That was, as they say, a shit show. It was a shit show from beginning to end. Excuse my language, but I can say what I want here because this is free speech television. Now we can say whatever we want here. And anyone that is out there that doesn't like my views on what to vote for should come here and start a show themselves at CTN. If you're here in the Portland area, there's local access stations all over Maine, but certainly come here because CTN5 is a great resource for everybody. Mm. Free speech is available, so because it's open to everybody.
Mm-hmm. It's great.
But I want to ask the audience if they have any questions or comments or.
So my name is Tanya. I have a question for you. So if you are elected today, do you have any plan, any project for the growing of immigrant here in Maine?
So you have a project for the growing immigrant community?
Well, we talked about that some. I think we need to welcome more immigrants, welcome refugees, encourage them to come to Maine because we need them here, and we should welcome them here, and they have a lot to offer and contribute to our economy, as we touched on earlier. And I think, making capital, access to funding for loan funding for starting businesses is important. Supporting them in the short term with a few months of general assistance help is critical. Till they can get on their feet and be contributing as they want to our economy and to our society here in Maine and in Portland. So there's the Immigrant Business Development Loan Fund I talked about.
Yeah.
That I'd like to revisit that bill, because that's a bill that I put in that I was not successful with, but I'd like to revisit that again and see if we can get support for it this time. At the time I put it in, the Republicans actually controlled the House and Senate, and LePage had just got elected, so it was kind of a tough time to put in a bill like that. But we had a really good public hearing, and many members of the immigrant community from Portland and Lewiston and other areas of Maine came to the public hearing and met our leaders in Augusta and other legislators, and there was a really robust conversation around that. So there's obviously a need there for that, and so I'd like to revisit that, again.
No matter where it's at now, because I wouldn't know what the resources are that are available, or if there's something that tells asylum seekers, if there's a way that they find out where the resources are. There's got to be some resources. I'm not sure what they are.
They're limited. So the general assistance funding for housing and food, that's pretty well known, I think, within the immigrant community, the asylum seeking community, when they first come here. That's really the only social safety net program that is available to help cover the cost of housing and food for a short time until they get green cards and can work and pay their own rent and buy their own food. But The ability to access capital and get funding for loans for business development is very limited at this point. And unless there's some kind of good credit or something to go on, it's really, really hard to get a loan. And so that was really why I put that bill in. Because
green card length of time, is that a federal thing?
Yeah, that's something that's applied through the federal government. And it takes like 6 months, sometimes longer, to get that green card. It takes even longer to get citizenship. So there'll be apply for asylum, and then they'll be applying for citizenship. That can take years to get citizenship. But citizenship isn't required to work, but the green card is.
If this election goes the wrong way, I will find, I might end up going to a country in Africa, and I hope that they have something for me when I show up, like where I can find resources, right? Mm-hmm. Whatever we're doing here, it's not enough. I guarantee you, it's not enough, and we should be finding more. I would say so.
Right.
Only that, we have to allow them to, you can't allow them to come here and then and then not allow them to work and not.
So you're on your own, live on the streets for 6 months.
It turns you would become a criminal. That would be your only choice, right? I mean, I can't imagine what you would do. So
I mean, there's a lot of like sort of rhetoric out there, particularly in this election, coming from Donald Trump's campaign, and it's just really, it's really sad.
It's really sad.
I mean, it's just a lot of anti-immigrant hysteria out there, and a lot of, you know, this talk about the wall, we're going to deport all these people and everything. It's just crazy. It's just absolutely craziness. Yeah. And I just, you know, I mean, all of this talk about, you know, immigrants coming in, refugees coming in that are going to, you know, cause problems and are a threat to our security. I mean, there's an extensive vetting process that goes on. It's very extensive, and you know, there's really no reason for anybody to be concerned about you know, terrorists coming in by way of, you know, posing as refugees. I mean, it's an incredibly extensive background check and screening process that takes place.
I love how they, you know, it's just like the way Donald Trump would bring up whether or not President Obama was born here. It's like, you can still, yeah, but it's not good enough. And and even though you and I know it, they can still say it on TV and say that there's no vetting process.
All he's got to do is say it. I want to build a wall, deport people, and there's this terrorist coming in by
point fingers at others.
All he does is just say it, and then everybody's all worked up and all charged up, and everyone's, you know, fighting with each other, you know, over it.
Is there anyone else want to ask any questions? All right. We're going to be cutting close here. So after this question.
Yeah, last question maybe.
What's your first name?
Anna. And I just had a question about the budget. I know that the last couple of budget cycles have been kind of tenuous. We've been threatened with government shutdowns, and I wanted to know if you could talk a little bit about what are the competing budget priorities, what's the debate, and what are your priorities, and how does that filter down to Portland?
So my priority has always been to get as much done for the city of Portland as possible, and regarding budgetary issues and funding, to get as big of the piece of the pie as possible as we can. So Portland is an economic engine in a lot of ways that generates a lot of revenue for the state through sales tax and income tax, money that goes to Augusta, and then we get some portion of that back. And I've always tried to make sure we get as much of that back as possible to the city in the way of education funding and funding for social services and things like that mm-hmm. we get state funding from. We've had some cuts in education funding. We didn't do too bad the last year. We did okay. We actually got some additional funding through education from the state. But we did take a huge hit on general assistance funding when the formula was changed for reimbursement from 90% to 70%. The city now pays 30% instead of 10, so we lost about $1 million there in terms of what we use for general assistance funding. So every budget cycle we try to do as good as we can, and sometimes we fare better than others, but the last budget we had some significant changes in the way that revenue is collected, which is what funds the state budget. So right. The state gets money from the income tax, which is about a third of the state budget's funded from income tax, about $2 billion a year.
Yep.
We get funding from sales tax, the meals and lodging tax, the tax on hotels and restaurants, that all that money goes to Augusta.
Yep.
And so this last budget cycle, last year, we made some changes.
Yeah.
And we lowered the income tax down to 6.5%, so it was 7.95%, almost 8%. We went down to 6.5% on that, and we made up for that loss of revenue by increasing the lodging tax, and
right.
increasing the meals tax, and increasing the sales tax on items that weren't previously taxed under sales tax are now taxed. So, like peanut butter is taxed because it's processed. Any processed snacks, so chips and popcorn and things that have salt on them that have something added to them are now subject to sales tax.
Are you kidding me? You guys up there.
And so there's a lot of new things.
Potato chips too?
Potato chips. But that is to make up for the revenue that we lost by lowering the income tax. But the income tax was lowered for everybody. So I didn't really like it because I didn't think that people that are in higher income levels needed any kind of a reduction, but everybody got a reduction. So that's what,
right.
you know, question two kind of helps correct that a little bit, as we talked about earlier. But
it couldn't be more fair,
but
by the way.
We did do some things that, like we added to the homestead exemption. So for property owners, the first $10,000 of value of the property was not taxed, is not taxed for property taxes.
Yeah.
And that's called the homestead exemption. So if you live in the home, and it's your home where you live, whether it's a condo or a home or house, the first $10,000 of value would not be taxed.
Yeah.
We raised that to $15,000, which takes effect this fall, actually, when people got their property tax bills in September. They probably noticed, if they looked at the bill, that the homestead exemptions now fit for the first $15,000 is not subject to tax. And next year, that'll go to $20,000.
Awesome.
And that's basically us in Augusta trying to do our part to reduce the burden on property taxes,
right,
because under Governor LePage and some of the cuts that we've had to income tax, we've lost revenue. So we've like shifted that over by not funding the state's share of teacher retirement,
mm-hmm,
and also education funding's been cut, and so that's kind of shifted that burden over onto property taxes. So cities and towns have had to raise property taxes to make up for this,
right,
because the only way that the city of Portland and South Portland, where you live, and other cities and towns, the only way they have to raise any revenue is property tax and a little bit of money they get on excise tax from car registrations. That's it.
Yeah.
And they're not allowed to assess any other taxes because the state doesn't allow them to. I'm in favor of a local option lodging tax, a local option meals tax. If the city of Portland could just collect an additional, 1% on the sales tax for anything that's sold in the city of Portland, they could get 1% on top of the 5.5% sales tax. That would generate a lot of money for the city in lodging. That's like mostly tourists. And look at all the hotels we have in Portland. If we could have a local option, like 2% local option lodging tax for the city of Portland, it would generate, tens or hundreds of thousands of dollars a year for the city.
Might be able to house some people too. Wouldn't it be nice from lodging to housing?
Well, what if you just did it during the summer months when the tourists are here, and then
right,
you lowered it back down
and
in the fall?
States, I mean,
seasonally adjusted sales
taxes.
You know, I mean, there's a lot of different things we could do but the state does not allow cities and towns to do that.
Right.
And every time we put in a bill to try to do that, legislators in rural areas say no, because when they drive into service centers, they don't want to pay more in those service centers if those service center towns decide to implement this local option, sales tax I wish they had the option to do.
I hear it. Now I've got my eye on the clock and it's getting close.
Sure.
Sometimes that's good. All right, we got to go.
Great.
LumenARRT, CTN, all these great people that help, they volunteer to bring the show. And you, thank you so much, Ben.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming. Definitely.
Yeah,
and we'll have you
me.
Again at some point, but I don't know when. But and thanks to guests for asking questions, important questions. Good night.
These memories undoubtedly will fade away, be replaced. But I'll never give me everything. You.